This video comes to you in 7 parts. And we are going to cover a lot of ground here. If you can't tell, this video is kind of long. But in short, we're gonna talk about how does the world reduce its carbon footprint? Is it through large-scale structural and societal shifts or individual actions? Who is we, you ask? Well, it is me and Climate Adam, who I am talking to via the interwebs. Hey Adam, who are you and what do you do?
I talk about climate change, mostly climate science, in quite a sort of playful, YouTubery way. So my goal at the beginning was to make videos that emulated my favorite YouTubers, not necessarily educational YouTubers, but just kind of like harness the silliness to talk about climate change. And I started that while I was doing my PhD, which was in climate science. And I guess it's been, oh God, maybe 4 years or so since I made my first video.
Oh, before we go any further, I want to let you know that Adam and I put together a sketch on his channel, which you can watch right now. I try to act so you can be the judge of how well that went. Okay, back to chatting.
Can I ask why you think that silliness is important?
Climate change is often, well, if not always, an intimidating topic. I think a lot of us are really scared of climate change, or we're just scared of being lectured about climate change. And so we end up not talking about it at all. I think silence about climate change is one of the things that concerns me most about it. And so by being silly, by being quite playful, I think it gives a lot of people a way in to think about climate change and to talk about climate change when they wouldn't normally. I try not to aim the jokes at climate change. I'm not saying climate change is silly. I am saying that I am silly and using that as a way to try and like give a little window into talking about climate change.
So speaking of climate change in the world's best transition ever.
In the video on Adam's channel, we're playing characters discussing what is a better way to mitigate climate change. Individual actions, something you do in your daily life, or large-scale structural changes, think government policy, industry overhaul, or cultural shifts.
It's interesting because I feel like there are two big debates in climate change. There's the debate that happens outside the climate nerd world, which is the kind of false debate about whether it's even happening. But then if you just are embedded in the climate nerd world, there's this big debate about what kind of action, or at least at the moment, the big debate is about what kind of action should take precedent.
If we're speaking in broad strokes, I tend to fall more on the side of pushing for large-scale structural shifts, whereas Adam leans more toward individual actions.
I think for me, that is not because I don't think the collective is important. I think it's fundamental, we absolutely need it. But I can see we're not doing that. It's very obvious we're not doing that, and we've been not doing that for a while. So it's sort of in the same way that some people say charities are not a good thing. We need to get to a world where we don't need charity. I sort of feel like, yes, absolutely, we need to get to a world where we don't need charity, but we don't have that world yet. So we still do need philanthropic organizations so people don't starve to death or die of preventable diseases. Similarly, for climate change, absolutely, we need structural changes. We're not getting those at the moment, so we need to cut our emissions in any way we can. And I think pointing out the personal ways we can cut emissions is helpful in doing that.
And from my perspective, my big problem with pushing for individual action is often in how those recommendations are conveyed.
Because it often comes down kind of patronizingly, like, hey, you need to change your lifestyle because it's your fault that this is all happening, which not only takes the burden off the big players that are the larger emitters, more emitting more than an individual person ever would, but also it ends up being kind of classist and racist a lot of times. And I think that's been a big problem of the environmental movement for the last like 3 decades, 4 decades now.
What I see more often than not is that the folks that are deciding what the individual actions we need to do are speaking from a place of racial and financial privilege, which makes it a lot easier to take those actions, all while they're simultaneously saying you're a bad person if you don't take these actions, despite many individual actions being all but impossible for a lot of people. What's even more frustrating about that dynamic to me is that if you look at who are the biggest emitters, it's the people that are wealthy, living in colonialist nations, who have the most capacity to choose not to fly or buy that expensive train ticket or have the time to figure out what emits the least, but aren't because they are running the countries and the companies that emit the most. And much of the every little bit helps conversations aren't aimed at the big emitters.
That being said, I subscribe to many of the individual actions. Like, I haven't eaten meat in over a decade, don't own a car.
Yeah, I think the idea of telling people what to do is not something I've ever felt comfortable with. What I've tried to do generally is speak about the things I've done in my personal life, like why I've done them, how I've done them, or like point out the difference that certain actions can take. But I think you're absolutely right. People like me, to be honest, often forget how lucky I am to have enough flexibility in my life to make these changes in the first place. I can choose to not really drive at all. Like, I live in a city with good public transport. I can afford to take the trains to places. I had a job, so I live in London, I should point out. I had a job recently in Berlin and one in Poland. I was able to travel to both of these jobs by train and bus, which not only proves how much flexibility I have in my time, but also like that was a more expensive way to get there.
I mean, the other big thing that I think about is that as great as individual actions may be, they're never gonna solve all of the problems.
So in the video on your channel, I make a joke about taking over all the garbage trucks in New York City and electrifying them. Other examples of things that no matter what I do as an individual, I'm not gonna be able to change are how concrete is made and used, the energy efficiency of every truck on the road, or how much electricity Amazon servers use. And there are loads of other things like that. Consumer choice can only go so far.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely true. There's some things that I'm not even able to choose. You know, there isn't a climate-friendly option on the market. So it's all well and good saying like, oh, market forces will push these things into changing. If there isn't an electric car you can buy, or you just can't even afford the electric car, then that's not gonna help. One thing that really stuck for me was just after the Paris Agreement, and I was among quite a lot of people who were quite surprised to see 1.5 degrees as the like ambitious target of the Paris Climate Agreement. I interviewed a climate scientist, Piers Forster, a UK-based climate scientist, shortly after that. And his response was just, the best understanding at the time showed that this was still something that was possible and that it was something that was really valuable for us to achieve. But if we wanted to achieve it, we didn't have really any choices left. If you could think of a way of cutting emissions, you needed to do that. Like, every single thing you could think of, whether it was changing power plants or changing how you fly or what you eat, just absolutely everything we need to throw at the problem needs to be thrown at the problem if we're going to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees. And there are some very good reasons why we should limit global warming to 1.5 degrees.
NBC Card linking to Adam's video about why limiting warming to 1.5 degrees should definitely be our goal.
The one thing that also really worries me, though, about kind of putting that out into the world is that so many of the things that I see people talking about, like, they're not gonna help, they might actually make it worse. And I feel like when we talk about climate change and we're doing climate communication, it's walking this tightrope between what's really catchy and people will remember and people will actually do, like what's sticky and what actually works. This like big push for local food, great for a lot of things, maybe not super great for climate change. Right now, this huge discussion of straw bans, almost no impact on global climate, objectively pretty bad for disabled people, only mildly bad for the oceans.
It's like the plastic straw thing, but here in the UK, we've got a 5p charge if you buy a new plastic bag at a shop. And since that's happened, so many people, when they find out I work on climate change, you know, if I meet someone out or something, you know, they say, oh, cool. Well, you know, I reuse my plastic bags. Like, hey, I'm helping solve this thing. And in one way, that's awesome that they're like, they're doing something that they feel is valuable and, you know, like they feel like it's connected to this thing. But it sucks because it's not really. I mean, that helps certain things, but that's not gonna help climate change at all.
I think that's really probably where the individual versus structural argument breaks down also, like it makes it kind of pointless in that the ones that become really popular, the structural and individual changes that people can get really excited about because they're easy to talk about, they're easy to understand, you can put them on a bumper sticker, kind of things like that. The impact compared to what we need to do.
I think it's important not to be absolutist. As soon as we start saying to people, in order to be good, you need to do X, where X is some total thing, be that vegetarianism or veganism or never flying, there's no room for conversation there. There's no room for the fact we all lead different lives with different access to different things. There's that phrase, I don't know where it's from, but perfect is the enemy of the good, which I think is really valuable for climate change, also just for the quality of my YouTube videos.
In the video on your channel, we do talk about kind of very briefly, what are some individual and structural actions that people can and should do? We've kind of talked about how changing your diet, even if just slightly, is great. What are some other kind of things you can do in your daily life that you want to recommend people do?
I think a lot of them people know about as well. So like diet and transport are the ones we talk about a lot. Apart from the obvious ones, I think the thing that people don't think about that much and is so ingrained in everything we do, and I think you think about quite a lot, is stuff, like how just like everything we buy, all the materials we buy, the cameras we've got, our phones, our clothes, all of this uses energy, it ends up emitting greenhouse gases. And recycling, although it's okay, it's, you know, it's not the end of the world to recycle stuff, it's so much better if we can reduce the amount we use in the first place. And when we've got something that goes a bit wrong, if it gets a hole in it, if we can repair it and keep it going and just avoid buying a new phone just because it's a bit chipped, or like there's a brand new faster one.
I also think that that kind of dovetails pretty perfectly into one of my favorite structural changes to talk about. This is a big debate, and by big debate I mean completely ignored but super important debate that's happening in the US at least with right to repair laws. And as our devices get smaller and thinner, companies do things to make it basically all one piece, which makes it very hard to repair it. And they aren't releasing the abilities for third-party companies to make bits to swap stuff out. So like right now, basically all I can do with the laptop that I'm talking to you on is replace the battery after my warranty's over and a couple of the other parts. But if the screen goes, or like a part of the screen goes, I have to replace the entire top of this laptop. With my phone, all I can really replace right now is like the physical body outside and the battery and the screen. So fighting for some kind of right to repair law in your area, while on their face don't necessarily seem like a climate change law, in actuality, if enough places have these laws on the books, the big Apples and Googles and Lenovos of the world are gonna have to change how they make their products and let third-party vendors repair them, which can help reduce how often we have to buy new laptops and new phones, and keeps us out of the planned obsolescence cycle.
There's some really amazing organizations I've heard about where you can go along and they help you fix your stuff. I tried to replace the battery in my electric toothbrush. I did successfully replace the battery in my electric toothbrush. I also got 3 soldering burns in the process. So for people like me who are terrible at this, there are also like places you can go where they repair stuff. The really depressing thing often is that it costs as much or sometimes even more to repair things than it does to just buy a new one. And I often choose to repair even when it's a bit more expensive to buy a new one. But I understand that, again, that's something that I'm privileged enough to have the cash. Like, I have the luxury of choice. I also try and buy things secondhand a lot to like increase, I guess, the demand for secondhand things and show that things have value after their use. Well, that's one of the reasons. The other reason is just because I'm cheap.
Yeah, I mean, when I first moved to New York, I just biked everywhere. And I told myself it was because, while public transport is great, if you can, it still uses fossil fuels, so biking is even better. And I am a physically able person, so I could bike everywhere. But really, it's because a monthly subway pass in New York costs more than $100. And I already bought my bike, so that was free.
You joke about it, but when you can find things which on a personal level benefit people in multiple ways, where like you can suggest something which saves someone money and time and also coincidentally reduces the greenhouse gases emitted, then it's like win-win-win.
This is by far the longest public video I have on this channel, so if you made it this far, thank you for watching. Thank you so much, Adam, for coming to talk to me on my channel. It was really great. I learned a lot. I had a lot of thoughts.
And if you'd like a taster of what exists on my channel, then check out the video we made over there. It's basically a super condensed, much sillier version of the conversation you've just seen.
I would love to hear from you all about how you think about mitigating climate change. Are you existing in this dichotomy between individual and structural shifts, or are you thinking in an entirely different way? As always, I will be hanging out down there in the comments. Feel free to stop by, and I hope you're having a wonderful day.
Bye.